My name is Jonathan Lloyd from MindSight. Welcome to this video presentation of the Adult Attachment Interview in Practice with Dr. Mario Marrone. Dr. Marrone is a psychoanalyst, psychiatrist, group analyst and drama therapist. He's written many publications and books on attachment theory and is currently the chair of the International Attachment Network. He was John Bowlby's supervisee and received weekly supervision from him for 10 years. As you may know, the Adult Attachment Interview was a research tool developed at Berkeley University in the United States, and the protocol is easily available by just googling Adult Attachment Protocol in Google. Many practitioners, including Dr. Marrone, believe that it has value within clinical practice. The structure of the event, which you're about to see, was Dr. Marrone working in a workshop and instructing pairs how to conduct the adult attachment interview. We hope that you enjoy this presentation, and please find further information of our workshops, etc., at www.mindsight.co.uk. Thank you.
Well, I start. I explained earlier today the adult attachment interview was devised by a team of researchers at Berkeley University in California in the 1980s. And the main researcher is Mary Main, who is very well known for her contribution to attachment theory and attachment research. And she was a disciple of Mary Ainsworth, who was one of the pioneers of attachment theory. Mary Ainsworth worked with John Bowlby at the Tavistock Clinic in London for a few years. Then she moved to Uganda, where she works at Kampala University, and then she moved to the States and worked at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. And Mary Main trained with Mary Ainsworth, and from then on, she inspired a number of young people in America who had been researching attachment theory and who have made a fundamental contribution to the development of attachment theory and attachment research in many respects. When Mary Main and her team began to work on this interview, they were working on the basis of John Bowlby's trilogy, Attachment and Loss, which is, there are three books that for anybody who has a deep interest in attachment theory, I think it's obligatory reading, you know? You cannot really understand attachment theory if you don't read Bowlby's three books. Bowlby has published other books, which are shorter, but these three books, I think, are very important. Now, if we were going to, if somebody asked me, you know, what is attachment theory? You know, how could you explain in a few words what attachment theory is? I would say that attachment theory is a body of conceptualizations that try to explain why we tend to form a specific attachment with other people from childhood to the grave. And how in early childhood this relationship influenced personality development. And in terms of what are the main factors that determine personality development in the context of attachment relationships, I think one is the formation of what Bowlby called internal working models, which are representations, conscious and unconscious, of our relationship with other people, but with significant attachment figures in our childhood, which is linked with memory systems, because this internal representation of relationships get inscribed in our mind consciously and unconsciously through memory systems. And we know today that there are three main memory systems in in the autobiographical sense, because I think we use memory to learn how to drive, how to speak a language, how to play music. But the important issue about memory systems is what memory systems we use when we internally represent relationships. And Bowlby drew attention to the ways in which information is stored in distinct systems of memory. And if we look at the different type of memory, we'll find that we have a short-term memory and we have long-term memory. And long-term memory, it can be implicit, it can be explicit. What that means, implicit? Implicit is when we get into our memory system a representation of events that remains at an unconscious level. And that this is something that has been intriguing researchers in the past 20 years, you know, how it is that our relationship with other people gets stored in our unconscious in ways that are difficult to represent verbally. They seem to have been stored in the part of the brain that is more connected with the rest of the body than with our cognitive functioning. But then we have explicit or declarative memory. What that means, these are memories which you can express with words, verbally. Some memory have to do with cognitive learning. You know, as I said, you know, learning a language or learning how to drive a car. But the type of memories we are interested in from the point of view of psychotherapy is autobiographic memory. An autobiographic memory can be classified into two types, semantic and episodic. Episodic memory consists of information that is stored in the form of temporally dated autobiographical details. Each remembered event or episode has its own distinctive place in the person's life history. So, for instance, when we were doing the practice in the adult attachment interview today, I said, well, can you remember a particular episode? I said two or three times. One is in the way of illustrating objective you use, or in the way of remembering a situation in which your parents make threats. So it's a way of trying to elicit episodic memory. And each remembered event or episode has its own distinctive place in the person's life history. Now, one of the interesting issues was that Bowlby said that episodic memory is something that we recall from within ourselves. It's something that we experienced, we felt, we remember. And that is very important because there were already a lot of clinical information about the importance of using episodic memory in psychotherapy. For instance, one key contributor to this field was an American psychiatrist called Selma Freinberg. I don't know whether you ever heard of Selma Freinberg. She wrote a very well-known paper called Ghosts in the Nursery. And what was happening that Selma Freinberg was working with mothers who were physically abusing their children. And she discovered that 100% of these mothers had been abused themselves when they were children. And that in order to stop them from abusing their children, she had to reactivate episodic memory. So when the mother said, my parents used to hit me, Selma Freinberg would say, okay, can you remember what happened as it was happening now? And can you remember how you felt? And it was only when these mothers could say to the psychotherapist, I remember how I felt, and I'm feeling it now, and that person will begin to cry, that changes begin to occur. So what Selma Freinberg discovered was that simply talking about episodic memories without recalling the associated emotions was not effective. What have to be, in order to for this recall to be effective, it has to be it had to involve recalling also the emotions that the person felt at the time. And she was very interested in doing this work, because with mother of young children, she said, I can't engage these mothers in very long therapy, because meanwhile the child is developing, and we have to stop this mother from hitting the child or physically abusing the child as soon as we can. So that's the method she used. And then when Bowlby was thinking about his own clinical experience and looking at the Selma Freinberg contribution, and he began to study the work of Talbing, who was, I don't know if he's still alive, an American psychologist who's done a lot of studies on memory, and in fact it was Talbing who described episodic memory at first. But then there is another form of memory, and which is called semantic. And semantic memory is a memory consists of generalized information about the world and the person's sense of self in relation to significant others. For instance, if I see a patient and I say, "How was your relationship with your mother?" and the patient may say, "Wonderful. You know, she was a very good mother." And then as we go on exploring the attachment history of the patient, we begin to find memories of episodes that contradict the first element. And so Bowlby came to the conclusion that semantic memory is contaminated by what the parents expect the child to feel and remember in accordance to the parent's interest. And I have a colleague in Colombia who talks about the official version. This is that every family has an official version, which is tries to portray the family in a much better form than they actually are. And so when I was working in the NHS, for many years I was a psychiatrist in the NHS, I remember that with the junior doctors, I asked them to find information about the patient's attachment history, and often they would say, an eventful childhood, they would write in the case note. And then when we had the opportunity to explore really what happened to this patient, when we were looking at their episodic memory, we found that there were all sorts of situations which were quite traumatic. And when I say traumatic, I mean something that overwhelms the person's capacity to normally process emotional states. So episodic memory may be at great variance with information stored in the semantic memory system. This gives rise to the possibility of cognitive and emotional conflict and to gross inconsistencies between the generalizations a person makes about his or her parents and what is explicitly implied or actually recalled in terms of a specific episode. You know, when we did an adult attachment interview and I said, well, can you choose 5 adjectives to describe a relationship with your mother, and then see whether you can illustrate one of these adjectives with a memory of your past, with an episode of your past. One of the things that we were trying to find out is the degree of correspondence between the adjectives, which are part of the semantic system, and the actual recall of event, because you will find that many people, there are inconsistencies. Also, because a number of people find it too painful to see the parents in an unfavorable light, or even to see the relationship as a difficult relationship. So they try to gloss it over, they try to disguise the pain, you know, and one of the ways they use to disguise the pain is to idealize the parents. So I have a wonderful mother, have a wonderful father. My father was so hard. Mind you, he wasn't never at home, and when he was, he used to hit us. But he was a hardworking man who tried to feed all of us. And so we are interested in seeing the degree of correspondence between semantic and episodic memory, and the degree to which a subject can illustrate with clarity and coherence his or her own semantic memories with description of childhood interpersonal episodes. So one of the things that Mary Main and her team discovered was that what was more important to give us information about a subject that we are interviewing, and I use the word subject and not patient, because we mustn't forget that when the Berkeley team started using the adult attachment interview, they did it for the purpose of research, and they did it with many samples of or responses to the adult attachment interview come from unclassified populations, a population which were not specifically designed as psychiatrically ill, was clinical populations. Because the main interest was at the time was to explore intergenerational transmission of patterns of attachment. And it was later that the adult attachment interview has been used to be applied to clinical population and particularly to psychotherapy. I think one of the things I said this morning was that I'm teaching the clinical implication of the adult attachment interview. I'm not teaching the adult attachment interview as a research instrument, because that takes a lot of time and it had to be done by professionals who are accredited to teach the adult attachment interview as a research instrument. But we will see, and we are seeing through this workshop, is how important it is to understand the way the adult attachment interview can be applied to clinical work. But one of the things that the Berkeley team began working with was the hypothesis that psychological malfunctioning, if we want to use this term, in adult life, was related to the degree of adversity that the person suffered in childhood. But what they discovered was that there was no strict correlation between degree of adversity suffered in childhood and an adult functioning. What was important is to establish the link between the way a person talked about his childhood experiences rather than what actually happened. And so they discovered that there was a degree of coherence that a person used to describe her childhood events would really matter. You know, because there were people, for instance, who had very difficult childhoods, but they could describe their childhood in a coherent way, and you didn't see in these people that degree of malfunctioning you would see in certain clinical population where there was severe pathology. So the conclusion has been, really, that in order to be able to describe your childhood experiences in a coherent way, you need to have a function, to use a function that this team at Berkeley called metacognitive monitoring, which is something about the way you know about what you know, and how can you express it. And my clinical understanding of this phenomenon is the fact that if you have a difficult childhood, but you have somebody who helps you make sense out of your experiences, then you can develop a reflective understanding of your experience. And in fact, this is some of the things we do in psychotherapy, because in psychotherapy we cannot undo the damage just by turning the clock back and offering the patient a different set of experiences. What we are doing in psychotherapy is to help the patient reflect upon his own interpersonal or attachment history. And the other thing that I also thought was that the reflective capacity emerges out of what I call reflective dialogue. You know, you can only reflect about yourself and your psychological reactions and your personal history if you have somebody who helps you think about that. You cannot do that on your own. So people who have that capacity to reflect is either because we have somebody in childhood help them think, to think together. You know, I also call that person the co-thinker, somebody who engages the child in thinking together. Or the child may have had child psychotherapy, or may have been in family therapy, or may have had a teacher who helped the child think. But there was somebody with whom the child could engage in this sort of shared reflective dialogue. And so people who are able to express their childhood history in a coherent way, you know, show a greater degree of internal integration. So what we are looking when we are looking at the way a patient responds, and when I'm using now the word patient because we are moving into the clinical field, you know, how do you, I know that some counselors call the patient's client, but because of the fact that I'm medically qualified, I find it very difficult to call the client somebody, because I always feel that the client is somebody who goes to a shop to buy something. And I am aware that in the counseling world, people who go to seek help are called clients and not patients. So if you use the word client, forgive me, because I tend to automatically use the word patient. So if you have if you apply the adult attachment interview to a patient, I think you will be interested to see the narrative content. You know, what were the childhood experiences that this person had? And I think there are some childhood experiences that cannot be dismissed as irrelevant. You know, if a patient tells you that he lost a parent at the age of 6, or lost a parent at the age of 10, or that his parents divorced and he never saw his father again for 20 years, you know, these are facts, and which we know have an important consequence on the child development. And the other thing we look at is emotional regulation, you know, whether the patient is able to show appropriate emotional expression when he's talking about some adverse situation, because there are patients who easily break down and they may start crying and you don't know how to deal with them because you cry and cry and cry, or the patient may tell you stories which are quite dramatic and tragic, showing no emotion. So we know that in optimal functioning, we are able to show emotions, but to a certain degree, you know. So this is what we put a lot of attention on, the capacity of a person to regulate his own emotions. Then the other question is the degree of correspondence between semantic and episodic memory that I have just mentioned, and the way the patient may use defense mechanisms to avoid psychic pain. For instance, you can see the patient using idealization, denial, projection and dissociation. We're looking at the form of the narrative. I think there are patients who their narrative is very short. They say, "Well, I have nothing to say," you know, and why do you want to know about this, you know? And it's very in the past. What important has now, you know? And we know that these sort of very short narratives are based on denial of pain. You know, they don't remember, because if they did remember, they would have to remember painful episodes of their lives, and they cannot deal with them emotionally. They are not equipped to deal with emotional pain. Or the patient may start talking in non-stop, and talks and talks and talks, to the point that you feel lost, you feel bored, you feel overwhelmed. I'm sure that all of you have worked clinically, have patients of that sort. And the other question is, what is the emotional effect that the patient had on you as interviewer? You know, and we are here in the realm of content transference. You know, you feel overwhelmed, you feel sorry, you feel empathy, you feel sad, etc. So what sort of emotion the patient evokes in you? So, what we may find in terms of the context of the narrative of childhood experience, we may find that the parents were affectionate or non-affectionate, that there was rejection or neglect. There is a difference between rejection and neglect. Rejection is much more active. You know, offering supervision to a psychotherapist the other day, who told me that she had a patient who said that the mother lost her husband when she was pregnant, and that and she found it very difficult to cope with a young child, with a baby, going through the bereavement for the loss of her husband, and that she turned out to be very respectful of this child, to the point of saying, you know, I wish you had never been born, you know, I wish if anybody had to die, you died and not your dad. And this sort of comment, which are amazing how a mother can say these sort of things to a child, but the clinical experience shows that there are mothers who are capable of making these rejecting comments. Also, mothers who said to a child, you know, I don't get on with your father at all, you know, and if it wasn't because of you, you know, I would leave your father. So the child becomes really the repository of the guilt, or the pain of the family. You know, I'm sure you had a lot of experience with that. The other thing we need to understand is the degree of empathy that the parents have in relation to the child, and role reversal. What is role reversal? The important issue in a parent-child relationship is the parent is fundamentally there to protect and look after the child. But there are many parents who do the reverse, you know, but they want the child to look after them, particularly at an emotional level. And I have a patient, for instance, whose mother, you know, she never could talk to her mother about her own problems, you know, because mother wouldn't listen, but she had to listen to mother problems. And mother will always turn around a carefully sitting communication from the child to put it at the service of her own narcissistic and selfish needs. For instance, this patient remembered one occasion she had a toothache, and she said to the mother, you know, I think I need to go to a dentist because my teeth is aching. And the mother said, oh, you know, I tell you about my history of I had to go to the dentist and I have once an abscess and so on and so on. So the mother talked for half an hour about her own dental problem instead of saying to the daughter, okay, well, let's make an appointment to see a dentist. And the other question is childhood bereavement, you know, and how the parents deal with the child's sense of loss when somebody in the family dies. And we know that the bereavement process is very much linked to attachment history. You know, there is a British psychiatrist called Colin Murray Parks, who has done a lot of research on bereavement from the point of view of attachment theory. And he said very clearly that the evidence shows that we deal with bereavement on the basis of our own childhood experiences with our parents. You know, and there is, I'm not going to go into that now because we haven't got time, but there is a, we have a lot of information about this now. The other question is, what were the parents' communications in the, when the patient was a child? We look at threats today, continuous criticism. There are the parents who are continuously criticizing the child, who are demeaning comment, making demeaning comments, etc. And then traumatic experiences, which involve gross neglect or abuse. Although I must say that in recent years, there have been a growing interest in what an American researcher called Carlen Lyon Roos calls subtle abuse. And she said that there are many children who suffer abuse in the sense that they experience a situation in childhood that they cannot easily process. But that this form of trauma is not easily described and seen by people unless they have been trained to identify them. You know, because there are many children who probably they had not been physically or sexually abused, but they were subjected to some form of interaction and communication on the part of the parents that really end up creating a traumatic situation in the child. So, the other thing we need to look at on the basis of what the patient responses to the interview is the emotions that get activated. Anger, for instance, the degree to which the subjects openly manifest anger in relation to mother or father. Management of feeling stemming out of childhood bereavement. And other feelings associated with childhood attachment experiences, such as shame, guilt, etc. So what are the main defense mechanisms people use to deal with psychic pain? Idealization, denial, projection, you know, or dissociation. And there has been a lot of research done on dissociation because one of the things that attachment researchers always say is that the main function of a parental figure or the main function of attachment figure is to emotionally regulate the child. But what happens with the same person who is supposed to regulate the child is the person who dysregulates the child. You know, so the only way the child has to cope with this situation is to make an internal split between one parental image and another. So, and to make a split between representation of himself or herself in relation to one parent or another. So, many dissociative disorders emerge in the context of having been, well, no, I wouldn't say that many, all dissociative disorders emerge in the situation of trauma in attachment relationships. Anybody wants to make a comment or anything? No? Okay.
Can I just ask?
Yeah.
You know, regarding dissociation, would you agree that so an avoidant or dismissive sort of attachment style actually incorporates sort of aspects of dissociation, that that's actually what's going on? You know, when they minimize sort of childhood experiences and stuff, or where they just sort of like literally almost just head off all sort of like emotional negative effects.
Well, in that case, I think basically more than dissociation, what they're using is denial.
Okay.
Yeah. Dissociation is much more active, but maybe we, if we have time, I'm just looking at my watch, you know, if we have time, we talk a bit about dissociation, okay, because it's a very important subject. So, Grice was a philosopher who talked about the form of the narrative and the researchers who created the adult attachment interview, they use Grice maxims that says what is important in a narrative is equality. Say the truth and substantiate what you say. The quantity, be brief but complete the message. Pertinence, be focused on the central topic. And manner, be clear and organized. And I think what they discovered is that the people who have, they have a very, very secure attachment in childhood, or they have an adverse attachment history, but they have the capacity to reflect upon it, can show these four qualities. And other people can't, you know? So as I said, metacognition is to be aware of what's on cognitive processes, involves the capacity to link cognition and emotion, also the capacity to evaluate the link between causes and outcomes, and the capacity also to be self-critical and productive and show productive thinking in resolving interpersonal conflict. You know, for instance, a patient who said, you know, I feel very neglected by my father. Because when he was a child, you know, he was quite depressed, he didn't play with me and so on. And he was a bastard, he was a real bastard, you know. And another patient may talk about the same situation in a very different way. He would say, my father really neglected me, he was often depressed, but I can understand, you know, that why he became in this way, because a lot of negative situations happened at the time, you know. His mother died and he lost his job. And he was unemployed for a long while and he couldn't find another job. And so I can understand why my father was depressed. And also, I think that I made my father very irritated because my response to his neglect was for me to become very negativistic and aggressive. So, you know, in this form of communication, the subject is understanding that when there are interpersonal conflict, it's not all to do with one person. You know, that that there are a number of factors contributing to a person's mental state and behavior, and a number of factors contributing to the interaction between that person and the subject. So cognitive metacognitive monitoring involves the individual capacity to take a step back and explore one's own cognitive processes as subject of thinking and reflection. Now we get to the point of reflective function. Peter Fonagy, whose name you may have heard, and colleagues, the Miriam and Howard Steele, the two Canadian researchers, who were working with Peter Fonagy in the 1980s at University College London, were using the adult attachment interview, and they were very interested in the reflective function that the person shows in answering the adult attachment interview questions. And it was to do with the capacity to think about the person's thought and so on. But one of the things that they were paying attention was the capacity of the subject to acknowledge that the other person have mental states of their own. And this is very important because, you know, there are people who never think that other people may have mental reaction different to their own. You know, and I, for instance, to be an example, I'm the chair of the International Attachment at Work. And in the past few months, we have a conflict with our Spanish section. And I try, on they are today meeting in Spain, and they're having a committee meeting. And I did explain to them why I was in disagreement with one of the key persons there, who did things I didn't approve of. But also, I acknowledge, you know, that they have their own way of thinking and that what I said may not be the way they see it, you know. So I show my opinion, but also open that they may make decisions that don't go in agreement with the way I think. And I think that this is an example of trying to be reflective and acknowledging that other people have mental states which are different from their own. And I think that if we look at politicians' behavior, you know, a lot of politician behavior believe that just because they are preaching a political ideology that everybody has to think like them. You know, and not only they don't acknowledge that people may think differently, but they are to be crushed if they think differently. And that happened quite a lot in families as well. So from there, I coined the term reflective dialogue, which is my way of contributing to this debate. And is that the reflective function emerges out of a reflective dialogue in primary groups. And if we look at the families, and if we look at group therapy as well, you know, or family therapy, you know, the way people use the interaction to work solutions together in a sort of a team context, it's fundamental for the well-being of everybody concerned. So reflective function and reflective dialogue emerge in the context of a secure relationship. Now, I'm using the word secure now. And I think that it's important that I clarify what I mean, because the attachment theory has, since its inception, and particularly through the work of many researchers, talk about secure attachment and insecure attachment. What secure attachment mean? Secure attachment means that the person has a sense of inner confidence in their availability and sensitive responsiveness and empathic availability of the attachment figures, whereas insecure people don't have this capacity. But the problem gets more complicated because there are people who have a secure attachment with one parent and an insecure attachment with the other. Or they may have an insecure attachment with both and a secure attachment to grandmother, for instance. So when we are talking about secure or insecure attachment, we are making generalization, because I think what's important is when we talk about this person has a secure attachment, we should ask in relation to whom. But what we know is that in insecure relationship, reflective dialogue and reflective function are poorly developed and are subjected to defensive distortions. And one of the things we know, for instance, is when there is trauma in a family, reflective function and reflective dialogue are often impaired. You know, for instance, look at the question of sexual abuse. Look, for instance, at a family where the father is sexually abusing his adolescent daughter or his adolescent stepdaughter. Often in this family, this is only one indication of family dysfunctionality. Where there is sexual abuse in the family, you often find that there are other indicators of family dysfunctionality. For instance, the fact that the mother is distant and doesn't want to know. And one of the issues in this family is that the family never talks about something that is important in relation to what's happening. And the father who is sexually abusing his daughter will never engage his daughter in a reflective dialogue. He wouldn't say to the daughter, look, you know, when I sexually abuse you, you know, what do you think? How you feel? You know, let's talk together about your feelings when I sexually abuse you. He won't. So I think that the impairment of reflective dialogue goes hand in hand with trauma in most families. Bowlby used to say what is most traumatic about trauma is not to be able to discuss the trauma with other people in a significant way. But I think that we see in a lot of dysfunctional families that trauma and an inability to talk about what's going on goes together. The other question is, there is a correspondence between reflective dialogue and emotional regulation. And we know, for instance, that we have a patient who comes to the session very upset and emotionally dysregulated, you know, and we talk with this patient, the patient may say, I'm very upset because my wife been rejecting me sexually for a long time and this and that, and he may be or may talk about other issues in that goes wrong in important relationships. And after talking for a while with a therapist, they achieve a high degree of emotional regulation. They're still, what's going on in their lives is still going on, but the capacity, the possibility of talking about these issues help the patient achieve a higher degree of emotional regulation. So reflective dialogue and emotional regulations influence each other. The other point that is important here is the question of intergenerational transmission. Main discovered that the quality of a mother's narrative of her own early attachment experiences predict security or insecurity of attachment in her child. This principle was later confirmed by other researchers. Well, I put the names of these people there for those who are interested in the, you can search literature. What happens when we find lack of coherence? We find contradictions, irrelevant comments, oscillation of viewpoints, marked fluctuation of tone of voice, senseless comments, incomprehensible or idiosyncratic jargon, endless sentences, irrelevant metaphors, and frequent lapses in language. Yeah, this is a sign of sensitive responsiveness. I'm going to have a secure attachment with Jonathan. So what sort of memory we may find in the patient? Memory of empathic, warm, and caring parents. Memories of rejecting parents. Memories of role reversal interactions, or memories of trauma. So from there, then on, the team proposed that according to the way a person responds to the interview, some were called secure autonomous. Why are they called autonomous? Because we've been seeing that people who have secure attachment have a greater degree of autonomy in other lives than people who don't. And the dismissive person is a person who tries to avoid dealing with his attachment history. And the preoccupied person is a person who goes on and on and on and on, talking about their childhood history. And then later they found a main and Hess. Hess is the main's husband, who is a researcher as well, and they found something they call unresolved in the relation to loss and trauma. And they paid a lot of attention about people who suffer traumas and losses, particularly in childhood, that they haven't been able to process adequately, and that and therefore that impinges about their capacity to have a coherent narrative. So secure attachment, secure autonomous are others terms, people who provide, whose discourse is open, free, coherent, and collaborative, presenting even difficult early attachment experiences in clear and vivid ways. And there are no contradiction between semantic and episodic memories of childhood attachment. There is a focus on the goal of the discourse and a rich use of language and expression. The subject demonstrate an ability to discuss and reflect. I'm going to put my reading glasses. The subject demonstrate an ability to discuss and reflect upon personal attachment experiences in collaboration with the interviewer, without disorganization, lack of memory, or passivity of thoughts. You know, when I talk about passivity of thought, you know, there are people who are passive in the way they respond to the interview. You know, you ask a question, you know, and you say, how was your, do you remember any particular episode of your childhood that would show that? Well, I don't know. Well, I told you enough, you tell me. I said, look, it's your history, you know, you tell me. No, I don't think I have anything to say. Or people who have a poverty of language to describe an episode. You know, the other day I was talking to a patient and she was describing a family situation of childhood that I would imagine would create a whole range of difficult emotions: shame, guilt, humiliation, anger, etc., etc. And when I say, well, what emotion do you feel when you were in that situation? She said, anger. And I thought, only anger, no? And often you find that the capacity of the patient to identify emotions and name them is very important, because there are people who, there are many situations in lives when we experience a whole range of emotion at the same time. But there are people who don't seem to be able to identify them and name them. And
so, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What would you do in that context then? You know, with that model, would you go with exploring the anger? How would you help a person to connect to the anger?
Well, at the moment we are talking about getting a picture of the patient. When we do therapy, I think that, well, there are several techniques we do, but basically I would say to the patient that I'm sure that you experience many more emotions like that, you know? And let's try to find what emotions were. And we know there are adults, we find adults who have suffer extreme and abusive attachment histories, but who can't understand coherently their early difficulties and may provide a coherent and autonomous narrative. You know, that can happen, you know. The dismissive patient transcript coded as dismissive tend to be excessively brief and are characterized by notable contradictions in the subject discourse about early attachments, with generalized representation of history being unsupported or actively contradicted by episodic memory. Could be a strong realization of caretakers in common alone with contradictory and impoverished memories of actual events. The interviews are notable for restriction in coherence and content, indicating a deactivating strategy with respect to potentially painful memories. Now, why people are dismissive? That is a result of several processes. One is that they haven't been trained to think about family situation, because their family never really discuss and talk about attachment issues. The other one is because of their own defense mechanisms. You know, they tend to eliminate from consciousness anything that is painful. And also there is a transference element, you know, because of the fact that they are in childhood, they had parents who didn't really perceive what they said in an empathic way, you know, they feel that the interviewer is going to react like a parent and will not respond with empathy. Some adults in this group minimize the importance of close relationships and derogate or dismiss the influence of attachment experiences, emphasizing instead extraordinary self-reliance. You know, they may say, you know, because self-reliance is something that people do when they feel that they cannot rely on other people. So, and self-reliance is also this self-reliance in terms of thinking, you know, and you, I'm sure that if you look into your own clinical experience, you'll find a lot of examples of this. But preoccupied, you know, in my experience, I think I have many more patients who are preoccupied than dismissive. You know, a lot of dismissive persons don't tend to stay in therapy. You know, they don't need therapy, you know? And the people who are preoccupied, they may come to therapy and may stay in therapy for years and always talking about the same thing, going round and round and round and repeating themselves and worrying about all sorts of issues, you know? And I have a patient, for instance, who is 60, and in fact, she's a therapist. But she's been in therapy for a long time. She's an extreme example of preoccupied case. And she's got a daughter who is getting married in a year's time. And she has already started discussing, you know, with a great deal of anxiety and concern about how is she going to feel in a year's time in her daughter's wedding, you know? I think we... Unresolved transcripts are termed unresolved disorganized when there is evidence of substantial lapses in the monitoring, reasoning, and discourse, specifically surrounding the discussion of traumatic events involving loss and of physical or sexual abuse. I give you an example. You know, sometimes you see that not only in individual interviews, but you can see it in groups or in family therapy. And the other day, I participated in a very interesting experience in Spain, where a colleague of mine is running what he called interfamily therapy groups. He's a group analyst and a family therapist, and he's combining what he learned from large groups coming from the group analytic field with systemic family therapy, and then he runs group with several families together. One of the persons in the group started talking about how he had two psychotic breakdowns. It was a man probably in his 50s or 60s, how he had two psychotic breakdowns in the past, and that the psychotic breakdowns were precipitated by remembering sexual abuse, because he was the object of sexual abuse by an uncle. And at that point, two or three other people started talking about their experiences of trauma in childhood. And then suddenly they became very hilarious and they started laughing and talking, telling each other jokes and so on. And I said to them, you know, that they were doing that in order not to continue stay with painful memories. And when I said that, you know, they calmed down and they got into a moment of silence. And then somebody started talking about the void, what he called the void. And the void says this is a feeling of inner emptiness where all you feel about yourself is a complete sense of being uncared for. And there is no one there for you. And then he started crying. But there was a moment when the whole group colluded with dealing with the pain, you know, in this hilarious way, you know. Okay, I think that there is much more to say, but I don't want to overwhelm you with information. In any case, you have the slides there and you can access the literature anyway. So what I would suggest is to have a 5 minutes break, and then we are going to sit in a circle, and we are going to have an open discussion until 4 o'clock, when we are supposed to stop. Yeah?